Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for this fall's second Grand Challenges Presidential Distinguished Forum. I'm Natifia Mullins, Director of Communications here at the University of Maryland, and I will serve as the moderator today. Launched in fall 2020, the Presidential Distinguished Forums are a series of events that feature renowned experts who are working at the forefront of today's most pressing issues, from the COVID-19 pandemic and climate change to the Black Lives Matter movement. Current national and world events present daunting challenges, but they also provide a meaningful chance to investigate today's issues together and help us explore new and better paths forward. Today's speaker is Philonise Floyd, younger brother of George Floyd and social justice activist. President Pines will formally introduce him in a moment. Just a few additional items about our hour together. Please note that we are recording today and providing live captioning. If you would like to turn on captioning, please click on the caption icon at the bottom of your screen. If you need to adjust the font size, you can access the setting by clicking on the arrow next to the start stop video icon and choosing video settings accessibility. Today, we will hear from President Pines, followed by a conversation with Mr. Floyd. After, we'll begin a Q&A session. If you have questions at any time, please use the Q&A feature. And now it is my pleasure to introduce University of Maryland President Darryll J. Pines.
Thank you, Natifia. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the second Presidential Distinguished Forum, which is also part of UNIV 110, the Grand Challenges of Our Time. We are just incredibly fortunate and delighted and honored to have Mr. Philonise Floyd here to share his thoughts. On May 26, 2020, Floyd learned that his older brother, George Floyd Jr., had been murdered by four police officers in Minneapolis after a store clerk alleged that he passed a counterfeit $20 bill. The world watched as Derek Chauvin knelt on Floyd's neck for what we now know to be 9 minutes and 29 seconds on May 25th, 2020. Across the United States and internationally, George's death sparked a worldwide outpour of protests against police brutality, especially towards Black people. It reignited the Black Lives Matter movement all around the world. His death also drastically changed Philonise's life. He went from being a professional transporter to a social justice activist, vowing that his brother's death would not be in vain. The day after laying George to rest, Philonise testified before the United States Congress, urging them to pass the Justice in Policing Act of 2020, which would ban chokeholds and create a registry to track officers with serious misconduct records. He also founded the Philonise and Keeta Floyd Institute for Social Change and continues to work tirelessly as a social justice activist. I'd like to welcome Mr. Philonise Floyd. Welcome, Mr. Floyd. How are you today?
I'm great. I'm just happy to be here and be able to speak with you all, Mr. Pines, and the young adults, University of Maryland.
So tell our audience today, who are you? Who is Philonise Floyd?
I'm Philonise Floyd, the brother of George Floyd. As you all know, my brother, he was murdered in broad daylight in Minneapolis by a police officer named Mr. Chauvin, who works for the Minneapolis Police Department. And he had his knee on his neck for 9 minutes and 29 seconds. And everybody around the world had watched a motion cinema picture, watching my brother having the life sucked out of his body slowly. And it was devastating to society. Nobody have ever seen a modern day lynching like that in broad daylight. People only talked about it, what happened in the past with our ancestors and things like that. But for you to be able to see that, it changed a lot of things. He woke a lot of people up. And people are coming at my aid all around the world because everybody wants to promote change, social justice. People want to be able to help. People want to be able to reach out. But young people like you can get out and speak out against what's going on in America today.
Can you share with us just at the moment when it happened, you know, what your family went through? And can you just share some personal reflections of what happened literally within the waning moments of what you were informed about the passing of your brother and how he was mistreated. How did your family deal with all of this?
It was devastating to find out. The way that everybody, because we pray a lot about everything, so we stuck together like glue, and we just told each other, we're going to be okay. Even though we know he's not going to be okay, we're going to be okay. Because I had people calling, telling me different things about, hey, man, I think your brother passed. And you don't want to believe stuff like that. You don't want to believe it. And you're like, what? No, this can't be. And for me to be driving, and I was on my way out of town, to get that message, I broke down because I had to call like my cousin, because my wife, she constantly kept telling me, hey, you need to come back home. You need to come back home. And I was like, no, I'm just going to get the money just like any other American. They're going to get some money to be able to provide. So to find out that it was happening, that my brother had been murdered, I called my cousin. As I said, hey, you need to find out some information for me, because my wife wouldn't tell me. So when he told me, I instantly stopped the truck. I went to a safe haven and pulled in a rest area. And I just cried. I cried for a while. And I called my brothers and my sister. They were crying too, because they got the same message related to them. And I just came home as fast as I could without, you know, doing anything illegal to hurt anybody, because I'm in a truck and it's 80,000 pounds, basically. You don't want to hurt nobody because it's hard to stop it. So from that point on, I had vowed to myself, I'll never, ever let this happen to anybody else. I will speak out. I will let people know about injustice, the things that I'm going through, me and my family. I won't want that for anybody. It's impossible to heal.
So tell me, how difficult has it been for you after, you know, that pain, that anger, to turn that into, you know, positivity? You literally had to transition from your current profession into a whole nother world that you had never really been in. Can you tell us, how did you transition from your previous line of work of being a professional truck driver to a social justice activist?
You know, technically, it's not really, I can say it's not hard to change. It's whatever you want. If you want change, you're willing to go out and try to get change from others. Like I said, I was a truck driver, but I also coached a Little League football team. Mm-hmm. So I gave speeches a lot to the kids to motivate them. And, you know, their moms and stuff there, and they always tell me, hey, the kids love you, things like that. So when this happened, I knew if I didn't get out and speak, it would be terrible. Because when my brother passed, I hit rock bottom. And I'm just being honest. I could have stayed up on the rock. But I know for me, I needed to be out to help families, help try to create change policies, try to make sure that this wouldn't happen to anybody else. So I went right after the funeral. I went straight to Congress to give a speech, because I was trying to get them to understand that his life mattered and all lives matter, you know, and people of color lives matter forever. So the things that people are being killed, like by police brutality at a rate now, and it's alarming.
So your brother, mm-hmm, passing and murder almost became a image of the Black Lives Matter movement. And how did that affect you, that, you know, out of nowhere, not only did you become an activist, but it reignited this incredible movement that had started many years ago. And not only did that movement start many years ago, as it happened in 2020, it went worldwide. How did you feel about that?
Oh, it made me feel good that people responded, because I look at things that happened with Trayvon Martin, Breonna Taylor, I look at Pamela Turner. I'm giving you names that you might never heard of, but But everybody know who Dante Wright is. That happened when I was there, out there in Minnesota. So it makes me feel good that people feel the same way that we feel. And their hearts was just like mine. It was broken and split into pieces. And the thing about it is people felt the pain, especially when he hollered out, "Mom." You couldn't tell me a mother that didn't stop what she was doing to listen. I don't care what race they were, they understood. If you know what wrong and right is, you knew that was wrong. He didn't have to do that. And believe it or not, it wasn't a mistake what happened, because a mistake can be made right. And it's uncomfortable knowing that I will never see my brother again. We were never going on a fishing trip again. I was thinking about him last night. It's just that he was like the matriarch, like the glue. He held us together, because we always knew we can count on him, get a laugh, and anything he was going to tell you, if you didn't, whatever you didn't want to hear, he was going to tell you, hey, what he thinks. So if you was thinking one way, he's going to say, hey, no, it goes like this. And you knew that he was telling you the truth, you know? So
then your family had to go and obviously have the four officers prosecuted by the criminal justice system and in the court system. Were you happy with the outcome earlier this year? And can you just reflect upon that?
Say that again.
Can you reflect upon the outcome of the verdict for the first officer involved, Mr. Chauvin? Did you feel that you got justice that day for your brother?
Well, it's more about I felt justice, but in reality, it's accountability. That's what we received. There will be no justice, because me and my family, we have already been given a life sentence, and he needed to be given a life sentence, but he only received 22 and a half years. But if you break it down, he's still a police officer, so he don't really have any priors, because they don't count the priors that you have when on the job site, when you're doing negative things to citizens of the community. They don't count that stuff. They only count if you go to jail for drugs or anything like that. He doesn't have a history like that. So for me to be there and waiting and pacing myself back and forth before I even went into the courtroom, and I still remember Benjamin Crump telling me, hey, Philonise, whatever you have to do, if you have to walk here 20 times back and forth, do it, because you need to be comfortable. That was your brother. And I understood it. And when it was time for me to go up in there, I sat down and I just prayed the entire time. I never looked up. I just prayed. And next thing you know, when the judge came out, and he started reading, he read a lot of numbers first, and then he said, he said guilty. Then he read another one, and then he said guilty. So I'm sitting there and I'm like, please, please, please. Next thing you know, he says guilty. And I immediately like was excited, and I wanted to jump up and down, but I couldn't, because it felt good. Just the problem is, we don't ever get accountability or justice as an African-American. You never get that. So anytime that you have that opportunity to, it makes you feel good. But I tell people all the time, hey, it's my brother. I love him, but this is bigger than my brother, because I was down there seeking accountability, and Dante Wright was killed while I was right there in the courtroom. He was murdered.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So how does it feel, Philonise, for you to transition into now where you are post the verdict and really a social justice activist, and you're almost like face of a movement? I mean, people know you when you walk down the street. They know your face. They know your family's name. They know your brother's name. How do you go from being unknown to so visible now? And how do you manage that? And what is that? Do you feel you're empowered to do social justice work?
Yes, sir. I really feel like everybody's empowered to do it. I don't think it's one person. I think it's more people because you can make a movement then. It's just people, some people speak out with riots. I don't want to speak out and have riots. I want to be able to have people with voices who can go out and do the same thing I'm doing, promote social justice, because that's how you get laws passed. That's how policies get passed, because you motivate other individuals who are at the top level, at the top tier, to be able to listen and understand what people want. And like I told you, I'm trying my best, but they took that George Floyd policing act off the table, and it was blood on that bill. You had Breonna Taylor on that bill. She was killed, and she don't even know that she's dead because she was asleep when she went to the door. Mm-hmm. And you also have my brother and Eric Garner, no chokeholds. That was taken away. But the problem is the qualified immunity. That is something that's holding us back. And these police officers, they want insurance, but you don't need insurance if you do your job the correct way. All you need to do is have your dash cameras on at all times and your body cameras. Never turn them off, because if you have to turn anything like that off, you're doing something you shouldn't be doing. And individuals out here fighting for their lives, hoping that they won't be murdered.
Can you tell us all what things you're working on in your social justice activism and in your institute? Just some high-level things that you are focused on right now.
Mental health is something that I'm really concerned about. You really can never tell if somebody has a problem unless they open up and tell you they have the problem. It's like an alcoholic. An alcoholic is not going to tell you he's an alcoholic. You're going to have to get him to admit, but they're going to show you signs. But you're not around people enough to know who has signs and who don't have signs. So mental health is something that I really want to work on, because I think a lot of people are being killed because of mental health, and a lot of people are incarcerated when they should be in mental houses, you know, getting help. Not only that, I want to work on sex trafficking. People all around the world, you know what that is. They're selling body parts. They're doing anything they can to get these young ladies. And I want to be able to help guide young ladies, because we need that power, no matter what race. It can be African-American, Caucasian, Hispanic. We need that power, because a good woman makes a good man. So you can go from there, and you think about, like I was just telling you about, these police officers need a registry. We need to know, hey, if you're living in Maryland and you kill somebody, you shouldn't be able to go to D.C. and get a job over there in that area. And we need to be able to keep up with names, because it's big, because misdemeanor, felony, all of it's the same. You're doing wrong. From there, it's so much, because like I was just telling you about Eric Garner and so forth, it's a lot of different things up under that law that we're trying to get, because the George Floyd Policing Act had a lot of different things fluctuating. And I think the only thing that they made it might have passed was they didn't want no chokeholds anymore. They didn't want no knock warrants anymore. But the qualified immunity, to me, is the key, because it makes more officers think about what they are doing rather than just do it like Nike, you know?
Thank you for sharing those thoughts. What I would like to do now is move to a session of moderated question and answers. And if you have a question and you're in our audience, please put your question into the question of the Zoom so that we can ask that question. We already have some pre-submitted questions, and Natifa, Ms. Mullins, and I are going to go back and forth asking Mr. Floyd a few questions. So I'm going to take the first question.
Can you hear that?
Can someone mute whoever that is?
No.
Oh.
No, it was okay. Somebody that came in the house, but they didn't hit the alarm. So I was like, can y'all hear that?
All right. Hope everything's okay there, Mr. Floyd. Following along the social justice work that you've been doing for now over a year, how do you feel that things have changed? Have you seen things change, and or how have things stayed the same? I mean, you've been working on the George Floyd, policing act, but that didn't go forward. But what have you seen that has actually changed that you're really happy about that you can share with our audience? That's one of our questions that has come from our teachers, our instructors that are in this in the class.
Well, honestly, nothing has really changed. People still are nervous about going out back and forth. People still have to have talks with their kids about like how not to be aggressive around Caucasian people. Make sure you let the windows down for the police officer to see there's nobody in the back seat, so they won't have a reason to murder you. It's just a lot going on. So hopefully I'm optimistic about things being able to change in the future, but they took the George Floyd Policing Act off the table. I guess they want to focus on the infrastructure bill. And to me, hey, this is a bill that has blood on it. People are like dying, you know, and we probably haven't seen nothing like bad. I'm just saying a week, something that was that people, everybody heard about. But believe me, the way that these police officers are using brutal force on innocent bystanders, hey, we got to get out and we got to speak out about this.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because I don't want a watered down bill. I want the bill to be passed. And I want, to me, that's what I want his legacy to stand for. That's what I want.
Thank you. Ms. Mullins.
Yeah, so we have a question in from the chat. And I think you said it, we all know that this has touched the hearts of a lot of people, Black, white, Asian, all demographics. And so we have a question, really it seems like about allyship. And so as a white person, I always feel like I'm intruding upon the Black Lives Matter movement whenever I'm advocating or protesting. What advice can you give to people who want to become or already involved in a Black Lives Matter movement who may not feel like they're supposed to be there or they feel like an outsider?
Hey, you're never an outsider when you're speaking up for righteousness. All you have to get out and just speak and be yourself. First thing you didn't know, you can't lose yourself. You have to keep fighting. That's the number one thing. You can't lose yourself, because if you do, you lose all of us and you fail us. You fail all the people that who were lost to social injustice. And the number one thing is never give up hope, because if you give up hope, you have nothing to fight for. You have to think about all your friends who you're around every day. You have African-American friends, you have Hispanic friends, we're all minorities. And if you can do that in society, in this world, and get out and speak, it's big. Because I know by you being Caucasian, a lot of people are going to look at you in a different way. But you have good people out there, because it was more Caucasian people out there than it was African-American people out there marching. And they were marching out there during a pandemic with COVID, putting their lives on the line. And to me, if they can do it, and if you were out there, I thank you so much. And if you were in the house and you were still doing it, I thank you so much, because I know where your heart was and I know where it relied.
And I'll just, you know, give you a Martin Luther King quote, which sort of says that, you know, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So we all must fight injustices, no matter what our race, ethnicity, or nationality is. Mm-hmm. So another question that came in is, grief is such a complex process. Mm-hmm. How were you able to move from the trauma you experienced to taking action?
Man, it's the nurturing that I received from my mom, being able to help people just like me, you know, understanding that what I seen shouldn't have happened. And I know there's no way that I can go back and get my brother back, but one thing I can do is get out there and change other people's lives, because you basically have to look at it. I'm turning my pain into purpose. Out of my pain became my strength. And my brother, he was somebody who I loved dearly, and I know of a lot of people who didn't know him, but just looking at what happened to him, it made you get out and march and feel bad for him. But at the same time, I think that us as people, Dr. King said he had a dream that all people around the world would join hands together. And the more we do that, we don't create division, we create equality.
I like your quote of turning pain into purpose. I've also heard you say, I need to make sure my brother is more than a face on a t-shirt.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Mullins.
So we have the question that starts with, you know, advocacy work is critical to impact change. I think we all have watched you and your family galvanize in such a powerful, inspiring way. We also know that it can be exhausting. It can be frustrating. It can be all consuming. I heard you talk about mental health. So how do you recharge, and why is it important that, you know, activists on our campus and in our local communities, that they're taking the time to recharge, to make sure that they are thinking about their own mental health as well?
Hey, the best thing is find something that you love to do, because you might not be into the activist work, but you want to support. So I love to fish. So when I have time to, I fish. But that helps me take myself away from everything. But the moment I get out that boat, it's not about cleaning fish. It's not about anything. The phone starts ringing even more. And people are always speaking and asking, hey, can you come here? Can you fly here? Hey, we need your help. Somebody has been hit in the head with a bat. It's always people. And I'm only one person. So once again, I'm always say, hey, we're stronger in numbers. The more people that get out and fight, I make this world a better place. Because you have to understand, everybody who was murdered, the only weapon that these people had was the color of their skin. It wasn't no other reason. It's no reason to have your knee on anybody's neck for 9 minutes and 29 seconds, having them screaming out, mom. That's not life. And if that is life, why would we want to even live here? You know, so I'm dedicating my life to helping others, because I won't change. I won't change not just here, I won't change all over the world. Because George, he's everywhere. The Amish even had posters and stuff, and they were out there supporting him. And the Amish don't do anything. They live off the land. For them to step out and be proactive, this is major. And anybody that doesn't understand that, this is a fight for all of us, not one of us, all of us. And we all need to be on the same page, all of us. It's a lot, man. It's a lot. I'm sitting here, I'm about to start crying thinking about all of this stuff.
So, Mr. Floyd, another question from some of our instructors. What was the most difficult step in taking a stand and speaking about injustice? So what was the most difficult step for you in speaking about injustice?
Just hoping that I say the right thing. You have so many different things going through your head. And just like when I went to speak in Congress, I never been around that many pictures in my life. I mean, cameras in my life. And people were snapping left and right, no matter where you went. It was a pile of people in one spot. And if you go from this wing to another wing, they're over there. And it seemed like it's the same people, and they're sprinting to get to places where they know you're going to. But to see people rolling on grounds, cameramen like ninjas, flipping back and forth, snapping pictures when I was in Congress, it showed me, hey, you're in the prime time on a stage at this magnitude. And you need to deliver the message. And ever since then in Congress, I delivered the message. And others now, we're like glue, we're sticking together, and we're all delivering positive messages all around this world. I just really don't know. It's just so much, because one thing that I tell my brother is the people who we love are only gone when we let them leave us. We got to continue to carry them with us. That's something we have to do as people, because You can't serve a purpose in life without having rocks thrown at you. That's honest God truth.
Do you see yourself going back to Congress at some point? You did a great job the first time making your case for the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. Can you see yourself going back again to reemphasize what needs to be done?
I see myself going back. I just need that opportunity when they give it to me. I think about a lot of stuff, especially about that George Floyd Policing Act, when they just took it completely off the table, because basically you letting me know that that's the way I feel. I shouldn't have to feel like I'm a second class citizen.
Right.
By law, I shouldn't feel like that. And to me, it's like just little things like that make people feel comfortable. No matter how bad it may be to pass certain things, but things like that bring out the best in people. And the government, it's like they don't care about equality and justice. It's like they care more about the dollar bill and keeping their foot on, you know, minorities' necks. It's to me, after that law was passed. So I'm optimistic that I can get other people to join me. You have no choice. You have no choice. Because the people, the people need their voices to be heard. Not just passing the laws for the elite and chosen, pass it for the people with no voice.
Thank you. Ms. Mullins.
Great, thank you for that. So we have someone who, I guess they realized that at some point earlier you had, you know, said a name that was unfamiliar to a lot of people, right? We know the Breonna Taylors, Denmar Aubreys, Dante Wrights, Eric Garner, that list is quite long. But we know that not every act of police brutality makes the national news. So how can we stay informed about these injustices?
Oh, that's why they got so much social media out. Stuff gets out fast. You find out about Christmas toys, clothes. It's easy to find out social justice, people dying. You can see music. You can see anything you want through a phone. And that's the only thing that makes it easier to catch people now is a phone. You have cameras everywhere. They record anything. Just like what we're doing right now in the past, you couldn't do this, you know? But now it's easier to be able to work from home, especially during this COVID. And people, they're gonna get out and they're gonna speak out, because a lot of people are into Twitter, they're into Instagram, they're into Facebook, they're into all of that. So if you're in New York and you see something wrong, you're recording it. You're gonna send it to somebody, and somebody's gonna send it to somebody. And that's when the chain reaction, it happens. And that's how you know when people are tired of something, because they're willing to record what's going on. And all those people that were out there at that time, I can really go in depth with the people that were out there. They were all out there for reasons, you know? And I really feel like the Lord put those people out there at that time to show that people want to help, and he still didn't want to get off my brother's neck. You had a little girl, she came and she testified. She testified in the court of law, and she told him, she said, I heard him telling him to get off of him. And she said, the bad man didn't get up. The bad man didn't get up. And then you can go with the other lady. She was an EMT worker, and she also, just like Mr. Chauvin, she had worked for Minneapolis department, government, and she wanted to resuscitate my brother and give him some help. And they told her no. So the Lord put her there, and he also put a guy there who was a professional in martial arts. And he knew what kind of hold. He said it was a blood chokehold that he had on my brother. And at that time, he said, I wanted to go and get him because that was wrong. People were there, and they were there for reasons. You also had an older guy who was there, and he had been through the slavery times, like racist times in the past, in the 60s and 70s. You can tell he been through all of that, so he know what's going on. And he cried. And he kept telling me how sorry. And he said he just hurt. And he said, man, he had a lot of passion for me. He said, because he said, you don't have to do what you're doing. He said, you're out here trying to reason and get people to understand that your brother's life matters, just like all our lives matter. And I told him, I say, I'm here for the people, because I'm still that same person that was driving a truck. I'll never forget where I come from. People all in my community, they have all type of murals everywhere. And they love my brother. The school, matter of fact, the stadium that he went to, the school that he played for, the stadium, they just named it after him. It's difficult knowing that so many people tried to help him. Sure. But yet, none of the officers listened. None of them. And one of the officers stated, hey, I think we should roll him over on his side because he was in a prone position. And he was like, no, just let him be. Mm-hmm. And I just don't understand what kind of hate, what kind of demons you can have in you to make you do something like that.
Well, Philonise, your work is inspirational. And because it is, I wonder, you know, what piece of advice would you have for young people who are listening to you today for the first time ever, who want to, in their own lives, make a change and address social justice issues? What advice or what piece of advice would you give them as they think about something that they want to do to help benefit society and marginalized groups in our nation?
Oh, that's pretty much easy. Just get out in the community, especially at the school. You can always find somebody that's involved in something. And I know some people running around there who want equality. They want change. You get with the right individuals who not doing nothing that'll get you incarcerated. Get out. Be willing to make statements. If you have to get out and y'all march together, it can be four, it can be five of y'all. Hey, the numbers will add up. That's what I always tell myself. It starts with one, but the numbers will add up. And if you all feel comfortable and you all want change and you want to make this world a better place to live in, get out. Be seen. Let people hear your voices. Let people know how you feel, because you can only speak how you feel, not by how everybody else feels. And if you feel like, hey, I want to get out because what I see is wrong, do it, because I'm going to be there with you, marching with you. In the rain, sleet, or snow, I'm going to be out there. And it's difficult thinking about it, but it's a lot of good people out there. And it's a lot of bad people. And the same thing with police officers. It's a lot of good ones and it's a lot of bad ones. You shouldn't have to sort none of them out. People should be good people, because that's what your heart determines, good people. And hate, that is something that you are taught. Nobody comes out the womb saying, I'm gonna hate on you and I'm gonna do this to you. You know, you come out of the womb, first thing you wanna do is eat and drink and cry. And as you get older, it's all about the right people around you, and they create who you really are and who you're going to be in the future.
Great. Absolutely. So I want to go back to kind of something you started to discuss. Seeing a few questions in a chat about your goals around police reform specifically. Every police officer isn't a bad police officer. So we have questions. A lot of our community members are wondering, what is your end goal? Do you think it's possible to successfully reform a system that is steeped in racism? Is it reform? Is it defunding? Can you talk a little bit about your end goal as it relates to police reform?
You know what? That's perfect. And I'm glad you said that, because Timothy Eugene Scott, the senator, and you also have Lindsey Graham. Eugene Scott got on the microphone and made a statement saying that we wanted to defund the police. No, we don't want to defund the police because you have bad people. I never said defund the police. I always say you got good police officers and you have bad ones. You shouldn't have to sort them out. Bottom line is, I want police. I think everybody needs policing. The fact that you have a lot of police that don't give African American people credibility. I'm hearing a lot about people being pulled over. They're having problems. Hey, this officer did this to me. This officer did that. It's pretty normal now, and it shouldn't be normal. Mm-hmm. You know, this is something that we've been having, like, things did to us our entire life that's a minority. Caucasian people, they really don't experience it because, you know, it's like we can go to jail for the same thing, mm-hmm. and you'll get a week, and they'll try to give me 3 months to a year. You know, we don't get treated the same. But one thing I know is defunding the police, I don't believe in it. I believe in having police. I just want police to do their jobs the correct way and not the bad way.
Ms. Mellis, why don't you go ahead and take another question from the...
Sure. So I know this has been a difficult time for you, but we do have someone who said that you are an amazing person, and they wanted to know, where do you get such grace and ability to translate your family's dignity in such an inspiring way?
I get it from my mom. You know, my mom, she was the nicest person on the planet, and everybody feels that way about their mom, but I can actually just say my mom was very nice. She took in a lot of people. If you needed a place to stay, we had a lot of my friends to stay with us, a lot of my brother friends to stay with us. She cooked for them. She even cooked for their mothers when their mothers came by, because my mom would always make a big pot of food or bake a lot of food. So the love that I have is the same love that she showed to everybody else. We would have big old thing of turkey wings, big old pots of oxtails. We had everything, even the stuff that you shouldn't eat. We had it coming up like chitlins and stuff. And the pork is bad for you, so I got away from a lot of that stuff. But everybody that came into their house, we would tell them, hey, you're gonna stay over here. You know, besides the rules and all that, we'll make everybody eat a banana mayonnaise sandwich. And even if it was disgusting to them, they know, hey, you gotta eat it or you can't stay here. But it was...
Mr. Floyd, one of the most moving images we had was your brother's daughter, Gianna, mm-hmm. who said, "My daddy changed the world." What impact did your brother leave on the world that he unfortunately left?
Hey, the world was already split in half a little to me, especially, you know, what was going on in the world. So unfortunately, when my brother was murdered, people seen that and their reactions was, hey, even if they didn't like African-American people, they were like, hey, I still feel what happened. And I wouldn't want that to happen to one of my kids. So I'm not gonna condone that. But Gianna, the statement that she made about my daddy changing the world, he woke a lot of people up. He made a lot of people uncomfortable. He made a lot of people who didn't want to talk about it have to talk about it because their kids were asking questions. And for me to sit there and think about my niece, we were just having a conversation. She called me and we were having a conversation. And she was talking about the type of food that she liked, and she loves creme brulee. Creme brulee, I hate creme brulee, but she loves it. just hearing her voice, thinking about my brother, really makes me, it just makes me feel good because I know that's him. That is his seed. And she acts just like him. My brother, he's just, he's just gonna speak his oath. When he speaks, people listen. Even when it was church, like we had our like outside church in the neighborhood and the projects we grew up in, a lot of people didn't want to go. But when my brother came and he went out, it's like everybody came out and sat down for church. And the pastor, he'll tell you the same thing, like, and nobody wanted to listen until your brother came. But it's just, her dad was so much to the community. He was so much because kids, he would cut their hair because it was low income. Nobody really had any money. And people, moms were so poor. I don't know if y'all ever heard of a chili bowl. You heard of a chili bowl? Mm-hmm. When you put and they cut around it because they couldn't afford it. So their mama would just cut it. And then the kids would laugh at you. So he'd laugh. But he would get out and he would cut like probably like 9 heads. And to me, I didn't even know he could cut like that until I seen him cut their head. I said, hey, you cut mine too. But you see, I don't have none now. But my thing is, I think he touched a lot of people, and people who don't know him, hopefully they'll get to know who he is through me. I get to show you and build his character, you know?
Thank you.
Thank a lot, man.
Yeah.
Thinking about all of that stuff. We did so much, man. And he taught me, like, when playing football, he say, hey, when I throw the football to you, he said, I want you to catch it. But he would never throw the ball to me. My mom did the same thing in the house. She would toss me the ball, but never toss it to me. And I never asked her why. I just thought she was a woman that couldn't throw. My brother told me when I told him, I said, I see why you play tight end and receiver and these other positions. He said, because I said, you can't throw one from me. So he said, man, I can throw. He said, but I'm not going to throw the ball directly to you. I want you to go get the ball. He said, the ball is not going to come to you. So right then and there, it clicked up here. So playing basketball, all that stuff, I remember him saying, hey, just keep your eyes up. Keep your head on the swivel. The ball can come to you at any time. And it was behind the back, through the legs, not chest pad. It was like coming anywhere. So my brother, he touched people in sports. He touched people with helping them with, you know, cut their hair and stuff like that. He also would give out like his old clothes to people that was coming up. Because my brother is taller than me, so he was always bigger than me. And I'm not going to hold your clothes for 5 years till I'm able to fit them. So it was this. It was my brother. He was different, man. And I think about all of this stuff. I think about him just standing by the wall, and he would scratch the wall, and you could see the little lines. And as he got taller, because he always wanted to be taller.
Right.
And he was a freak of nature. That's what everybody used to say. He was a freak of nature because he was like 6'6". He can run fast like a receiver. And he was too big to be, he was too fast to be a tight end. He was just a huge dude, and he can jump. He can do backwards flips. He can dance. Basically, I'm going to say, you think of Shaquille O'Neal and you think of LeBron James. And that was him.
Mm.
One of a kind. But he knew how to inspire children to be great and better. And he also talked to a lot of adults, especially people who were into like gangs and stuff. He always say, hey, look, they don't love you. Your mama loves you. That's who loves you. Because when you get in trouble, you're going to call your mama. Mm-hmm. And when he relays messages to young kids like that, which they call the youngins, young kids, they were listening because they were inspired by him. They loved him because especially people who played sports wanted to be like him. Mm-hmm. But also people who was telling me like that in his age group, they had group assignments in school. And they said that we thought because he was an athlete, he didn't know a lot, but they said you find out that he brought more to the table than we thought, you know what I mean? So I think her dad did a lot for the world, but most importantly of all, I think he woke a lot of people up to racism who said it didn't exist.
Ms. Mullins.
Yeah, I mean, clearly your mom did an amazing job with you and your siblings, because you all are inspiring in so many ways, right? The death of George Floyd, definitely, but you all picking up the torch and doing this work is just been an inspiration to so many. And those themes are coming in the comments. Everyone is just so grateful to have you here, thankful to you for sharing your story. And so when you transitioned into social justice work, we know that there were a lot of activists, you know, the Al Sharptons of the world, the Ben Crumps of the world. Was there anyone in particular that you drew your inspiration from?
You know what? Reverend Al Sharpton, he always told me to keep fighting. And Benjamin Crump, he always told me to speak from the heart for people to know where you stand. Mm-hmm. When I look at a lot of different people, I even look at women. I looked at and I was thinking about Tamika Mallory. I was like, I even asked her, I said, how do you think about the things that you want to say in that moment, in that time? And she said, my dad was a police officer. I think her mom was a police officer too. So she incorporated a lot of different things. I guess they was telling her different tactics and stuff like that. But man, Dr. King, I read about Dr. King, I read Malcolm X. It's a lot of individuals. I even read about John Cochran. It's a lot of individuals who I read about, Obama. Just different people, you know, and everybody don't have to be African American who I read about. I just like reading about different people, because one of the comedians that I read about was George Lopez. George Lopez, just trying to see about, you know, his life, because he inspires me a lot, because when he talks about stuff, he talks about how he came up in life, and, you know, I listen. And he said a lot of positive things, but he gave you how Hispanics grew up. And I like to know how different cultures grow, because I see different cultures every day. You know what I mean? So Bill Clinton, I even read about Bill Clinton. It's, to me, everybody, it's like gumbo. Put everybody in one pot. And that's what I do. I just collect and collect and constantly collect. Because people, man, they speak from the heart, and they're going to tell you different things, but you'll be able to remember little by little what you can remember, because whatever plays a part in your life, you will always be able to come back there together with anything else. So, oh God, I had so many people that inspired me, like Sheila Jackson Lee. She's from Houston. Barbara Jordan was somebody who inspired me. You know, it's a lot, but I always tell people my mom is one of the big people who inspired me to just be nice to people and make sure that if it's somebody hungry, make sure you can feed them if you could. I drove down the street the other day, and I seen a Caucasian guy. He had Black Lives Matter. He had Black Lives Matter on. And I was like happy. And I had gave him $10. And then it was another lady. She was Black. She had a sign up, but I seen Floyd at the bottom, and she moved the sign, and it had a shirt that I had never seen before. And I seen a lot of them. I said, "Oh, I like that shirt. I got to get that shirt," because it was colorful and everything. And it said, "Finally, justice for George Floyd." It was a beautiful shirt, and I gave her some money too, and she was just thanking me and crying, because when she realized, when she came to the car and got the money, she realized who I was, she just started crying. She was homeless, but she started crying. You know what I mean? But I'm like, homeless people know you, and that stuck with me. Homeless people know who you are. They don't watch TV that often, but you never know who's homeless and who's not homeless. But she was homeless, but she knew who I was, and she started crying. He said, thank you so much.
Well, Mr. Floyd, we're coming to the close of our time with you. And I, you know, just want to say you're an incredible inspiration to humanity. and a credible inspiration to your brother's legacy and to the future of this country and the good work that you're doing as an activist. And I want to leave you with another Reverend Martin Luther King quote, which I think really epitomizes what you're doing, which is, "The ultimate measure of a man is not where one stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where one stands in times of challenge and controversy." We are in those times right now, and Mr. Floyd, you are a beacon of light. And we are deeply, deeply grateful for you coming today to the University of Maryland and this Presidential Distinguished Forum and sharing your personal thoughts about your brother and your cause for criminal justice reform. And we want you to continue the good fight, and hopefully you've inspired many students here at the University of Maryland that they too can do great things. They have a passion and conviction to do it. So I'll turn it over to Ms. Mullins, but I wanted to thank you for being here today and speaking to our University of Maryland community.
Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Hey, before I, this is Maryland, the Terps.
Yes.
And yeah, this Terps. Is Steve Francis. I'm thinking about Steve Francis. I do work with him.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he's from Houston.
Yeah. No, yeah. He's from out there.
Is he from, he played for Houston. He played for the Houston Rockets.
He played for the Rockets, but yeah. He went to school at San Jack, which was a junior college, but he had to leave Maryland.
That's
to
come right.
Down, or D.C., Maryland or D.C., he left.
Right.
And he came down here, and he went to school. Now he went to Maryland because it was a JUCO. He went to Maryland.
Correct.
And Maryland, right. He became a Houston Rocket.
That's right.
Yeah.
Memory.
Well, listen, thank you so much for joining us. We had a really great conversation, and I'm sure our campus community has left. We'll leave so inspired. So to everyone joining us, wanted to remind you to mark your calendars for the next Presidential Distinguished Forum that will take place on Monday, November 1st at 4 p.m. President Pines will host a conversation with University of Maryland alum Ethan Brown, the founder of Beyond Meat. So again, thank you all for joining us, and see you around.